closer to what Kaust is doing, and on the geoscience end, but also is going to bring us closer to the theme of the conference, which is the scientific and technical issues related to geological storage of carbon. And so let me start by briefly analyzing the severity of the situation. We produce 80 tera, no, excuse me, the size of the economy is 80 tera dollars, which is 10 to the 12. And that requires an energy consumption in the order of 160 tera kilowatt hours. And to do so, we produce every year 40 tera kilograms of CO2. You may think that these are weird units, but it allows me to cancel the teras and say that for every dollar in the economy, we are consuming 2 kilowatt hours and we are releasing 0.5 kilograms of CO2 into the atmosphere. And this is where our challenge is. There is an intimate relationship between the economy, energy, and carbon, at least with the current energy mix. And the second observation is that this is a tera problem. And it requires not one solution, but a combination of solutions, as Vice President told us. And the combination of those solutions, however, has to be a tera solution. Finally, before leaving this slide, I would like to focus once again on the link between the economy, energy consumption, and CO2 release. This has also implications for the choice of alternatives that we're going to undertake. For example, what that relationship tells us is that $1 million of life cycle cost, and please let's be clear about this. This is not just the cost of beginning the installation. It has to be life cycle cost. $1 million of life cycle cost must store at least 500 tons of CO2 for several centuries in order to be at least a carbon neutral solution. Folks, this is a challenge. So at Kaust, you heard from Donald Bradley that we have started a circular carbon economy initiative that has several segments. We took responsibility for the geo solutions. And we realized that in the geo solutions, and it's very similar to what Dr. Gassem and Aidan were telling us about what the minister is recognizing at Aramco, we have to develop more efficiency hydrocarbon recovery, adequate enhanced oil recovery techniques, minimize H2S release and CO2 release, and in fact, capture it and bring it back to the subsurface in different forms. Some of them will be discussed later on in the presentation. We also would like to explore non-carbon economies, and we saw many of those examples in Dr. Gassem's presentation at the beginning, including the geothermal, the possibility of storing energy in multiple forms in the subsurface, and also for the waste storage, that will be a geo solution for the nuclear sector, which has also been initiated in the kingdom. To put a few numbers to this effort, the kingdom produces approximately 12 billion million barrels a day, barrels per day. That is an embodied CO2 of approximately 2 tera kilograms, something like 2 out of the 40 that the world produces. Two of those are the embodied CO2 in the oil that the kingdom produces. It injects in the order of 0.9 billion kilograms, so 1 over 2,000 of the actual embodied CO2 produced. This tells us the magnitude of the problem, but also now there is a huge complexity in geological storage of carbon. And part of that stems from the fact that if we're going to do it in liquid form, the viscosity of supercritical CO2 is 100 to 1,000 times lower than the viscosity of water, that there are complex issues with interfacial tension and contact angle and wettability and capillary phenomena. That many times what we do in the laboratory are very short time tests. However, if you just look at what happens with the fluid inside the capillary tube trapped here, let's say water surrounded by your supercritical CO2, this is a very time dependent process. 50 days later, the reservoir looks completely different. Then when we have fractures, we have a multi-porosity medium that is going to create unique invasion and displacement situations. And because of capillarity and viscosity, we're going to go into the reservoir in the form of viscous fingering rather than a stable displacement. The last movie that you may have seen here also tells us about what will happen with those interfacial phenomena in the presence of fine particles, which are going to be in the reservoir, but that we may use to engineer proper seal mechanisms. On the other side, we have the hydrochemomechanical phenomena that are related to the acidification of water when we inject CO2, which is demonstrated in the movie in the center, which leads to convective currents. And these convective currents, the CO2 here is at the top, and then the green water has a pH indicator. These convective currents are going to continue circulating the products of dissolution, probably leading to the acceleration of localized dissolution processes. And this is what we see on the figure on the left, that depending on the rate of reaction and the rate of advection and diffusion and advection in Peclet's number, the invasion into fractures is going to be significantly varied depending on what regime we are in the formation, in the reservoir. Finally, the figure on the right is actually a movie that shows that when dissolution takes place in our sandstones and shales and in our rocks, it's not going to be that homogeneous. It's also going to lead to shear failures, and we have to wonder about the long-term stability of the seals. To avoid some of the challenges with fluid storage, the possibility of solid storage comes across as a wonderful opportunity. One mechanism is the form of hydrates. We don't have the conditions anywhere around the kingdom for hydrate storage, but maybe a viable alternative for others around the world. The other ones is to, the one that is more viable in the kingdom is mineralization of CO2, particularly in mafic rocks, in the basalts. Now you will say, you must wonder, but there is not enough fracture space. Well, you can do the calculations further. I'll give you some examples, but there is another possibility for delayed passivation of the system that leads to the success in Iceland, and that is the formation, the crystallization pressure that tends to break the rocks, creating new surfaces, as well as advective diffusion reactions into the formation. If you are here at KAUST, or next time the audience outside can visit us, we'll walk you around campus and we'll show you some of the most beautiful rocks that we have. And you will see these Lissegang bands and the products of diffusion, fracturing and diffusion in the rocks that show some of these mechanisms actually have taken place throughout the geological history. So given the complexity of these processes, we have to say, in what regime are we in? And yes, it's nice to think of Peclet number for diffusion and advection, but there are other complications related to the variety of phenomena that I have just presented. So this is what, sorry, I apologize. This is the excitement from a scientific point of view and the challenge from an engineering point of view. And in order to confront it, we have put together a very large team here at KAUST, many colleagues throughout KAUST, and colleagues, collaborators around the world. And so far, we are advancing 8 different projects, which I'm going to briefly summarize next. The first one is intimately related to initiatives taking place in the ministry, as well as Aramco, and in fact, we are collaborating with them. and it is to define an atlas of the storage capacity in the kingdom, with very specific studies in the area of Riyadh and Yanbu. And these are some earlier results that are taking place, and some of the magnificent modeling, and with huge numerical demands that leads also to the development of new numerical techniques. The next project is looking at pore scale phenomena, some of those that I described above, and the similar to complementing with Aramco on enhanced recovery, enhanced oil recovery, but in this case, we're pushing for the thought of gravity assisted recovery while at the same time storing CO2. And we go all the way from the pore scale to scales that are equivalent to the reservoir. And what you see there, Marcelo is standing up next to one of the samples, and this one can be telescopically connected to make an actual reservoir several meters in thickness. The possibility of mineralization in mafic rocks is inspired by the great achievements in Iceland. We are going to hear more throughout this week. And just to give an example, one of the harads here, and there are many in the western side of Saudi Arabia, look at it, it's 300 kilometers long. It's readily visible when you step out of our campus, and the rocks are significantly fractured because you need fractures, you need depth, you need water, and the right mineralogy. And this is the scope of this project, which involves both geology, geochemistry and thermodynamics, extensive laboratory experimentation, complemented with numerical simulations. The last two projects that I'm briefly presenting is the geothermal. Geothermal not as an alternative source of energy by itself, but also complemented with the utilization of CO2 as the exchange fluid to enhance heat recovery. And finally, we are very cognizant of the fact that if we're going to go into renewables, storage becomes a major issue. So there is a significant, very creative project going on the wide range of possibilities that we can use to store and make use of different depressions throughout the kingdom for gravity effects, etc., and pressure effects. Closing thoughts. I think that, like all new technology, at the beginning of any new technology, a new bridge, a new space shuttle, etc., there is high probability of failure. And we have to be careful that this is not just a Falcon bargain, that we are not playing a game with the devil to inject and then without having a proper understanding of what is going to happen. Clearly, CO2 geological storage is needed, but there are complex couple processes that need to be properly understood. And that is partially the reason why the high probability of failure at the beginning. And there will be leaks. And then we have to wonder, are they acceptable? We recognize that we are going to lower the efficiency, the exergy in the system, but also how long do we want it? CO2 is not a radioactive waste. Will be comfortable if it begins leaking in 200-300 years from now, and the possibility of engineering self-healing systems. This is a wonderful challenge for science and engineering. We sincerely believe the problem is far from trivial, and it requires all of us coming together to solve it. At KAUST,